वेलकम डॉक्टर रामा राजू सर ऑफिशियली. सर यू आर अ ग्रेट पर्सनालिटी, अ सिंपलेस्ट ह्यूमन बीइंग आई हैव एवर सीन. एंड आई वाज लकी इनफ टू अटेंड योर ट्रेनिंग एंड माय वीक वन वीक ऑफ ट्रेनिंग एट योर प्लेस वाज एक्सीलेंट एक्सपीरियंस. आई मस्ट शेयर विद एवरीवन हियर दैट नॉट ओनली आई लर्न द टिप्स एंड ट्रिक्स ऑफ IVF बट आई लर्न अ लॉट अबाउट अ सिंपल ह्यूमन बीइंग विच वी आर सीइंग हियर. And we are immensely and proudly welcoming you, sir. And sir, I learned you are so fond of teaching that you keep on taking the lectures for us. And it was really a privilege to learn from you directly. And my 1 week over there was excellent. And not only you, your whole staff, your sisters, your management, excellent management. And that we have imbibed in our center also. And your SOPs, your making of management skills were so good. And your staff is so humble. Your all doctor teams are very good. So I keep telling everybody at my center, and we keep on admiring you. And there's a lot to learn from you. And I think for generations, in IVF at least, we have to learn from you, sir. How to do research, how to do patient management. Everything. So here you are with us, and I think we'll keep on in troubling you again and again for certain topics because we want to learn from you. Thank you very much for sparing your time. And now Dr. Megha will share your CV.
Thank you, sir, for accepting our invitation. And that's right, every other day we hear about you and your center through ma'am. And it was an honor to listen to you today. And now I feel that now I would introduce Dr. Rama Raju, sir. He is the founder and director of Krishna IVF Center in Visakhapatnam, which is the first IVF clinic in its region. It's an extramural research center for universities and offer mentorship programs in reproductive medicine. Apart from clinical acumen and expertise, sir holds many esteemed positions at various institutes. He is the author of many textbooks, publications, and over more than 600 citations to his name. Lastly, many awards and honors adding feathers to his crown. So words fall short of the praise. He would now speak on a very burning topic today, an unexpected poor response in a normal expected cycle. So over to you now.
First of all, I thank the Delhi Society for inviting me and Dr. Seema for all the kind words. And Dr. Sushma for all the kind words, and not but the least, Dr. Colonel Sharma, whom I spent 1.5 days with his RR center, where he has built the RVIVF from scratch, and used to do thousands and thousands of IVF single-handedly. My hats off to him. I always admire in the public sector, a beautiful IVF clinic being organized in such a beautiful way. And when I first saw that, I was fascinated and also humbled by what can a single person do, where the team he had was all raw manpower, and whatever the Army IVF that is today, it's all because of his great vision. Many people can start an IVF, but many people can't start a chain of IVF centers in the government setup. It's quite near to impossible. Fighting with the bureaucracy, fighting with the system, and training raw hands every year because in army they keep on transferring them. Hats off to you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. In fact, so many papers have come from Krishna IVF Center, and you know, the patients, when they bring their documents, you know, they it's really fascinating how, you know, well documented, you know, the procedures are done in the Krishna IVF Center. And I think that can be universally utilized by all the IVF centers in the country. You know, you can make a SOPs, you know, which is already you are following it. I think if all of us follow your SOPs, sure, you know, patients would be benefited and the centers would do much better research also.
Battery.
That is very right, sir. Sharma sir, really we have seen you working as embryologist, as a clinician, as a counselor, what not, for a patient. So it's great to see you working, and that too with a smiling face and not getting irritated anytime. That is excellent. With overburdened with so much of work and you can control yourself, that is excellent.
Thank you.
It's very right.
My slides are visible.
Yes.
Lot of times when we go through an IVF cycle, we end up with a surprise called unexpected poor response. And in this talk, I would like to share some of the experiences so that most of us can avoid that situation by following certain precautions, which I'm going to outline next. The first thing is we should have a clarity what we want, because the scientific leaders of our society around the world have put on different statements as follows. Some say more research the better. Some say normal, that is 8 to 15 oocytes is the best. Others say we need eggs, not all the eggs. And then we have data saying 100 eggs will give 6.5 babies. So we at the receiving end are a lot of times confused what is ideal stimulation. And each has to define their own ideal stimulation in their given setup and in the given situation and in their given background information, be it minimal stimulation, maximal stimulation, or optimal stimulation. That's a call each has to take individually. The second area is, lot of times we confuse between a hyper-responder and a poor responder. Unless we have clarity between these two situations, most of our stimulation protocols will not go properly. If we are dealing with a poor responder patient, whatever we do, we are not going to increase the number. But when we are dealing with a hyper responder patient, there are ways and means to avoid that hyper response, both during that cycle and in the subsequent cycle. When we say unexpected poor response in a good responder, all of us are speaking the topic of a hyper responder, not the poor responder. In other words, in the current world of Posidon classification, is the Posidon 1 and 2, which are the hyper responders, and the Posidon 3 and 4 more come closely to the poorer responder group. We should have clarity on that. The second area is, we should have a lot of clarity in the following nomenclature: follicle output ratio, follicle to oocyte pickup ratio or FOI, and ovarian sensitivity index. What we are speaking in this situation is, we have a follicle output index where you have X number of follicles, and when you pick them up, you should get the X number of stimulation. One of the things we follow is, in each of the protocol, when we do a stimulation, we write what is the anticipated number of eggs we are going to get. And this was a powerful learning experience for us, because in the beginning, we had a lot of hard knocks of we writing 12 oocytes and getting 6 oocytes in the stimulation protocol. Unless we do our own key performance index or the KPI from the industry, saying that what is your KPI for your stimulation protocol and how often you're coming close to the 90th percentile of what you predicted, only then you will be able to refine and understand where we failed, and then only our stimulation protocols will improve. The other key concept is anti-Müllerian hormone and antral follicle count are the key factors that drive our practice today. Earlier, they were the ovarian volume, the FSH, the stimulation tests, the previous responses, but more and more we are moving only to these parameters. But we should understand that there are still limitations in this, and these can vary. We should not anticipate an X number of follicles in a particular age. When you look at the AMH levels in this slide, where based on the age you have a nomogram, and using this nomogram, if you optimize your dosage of stimulation, you'll go a long way. Similarly, when you use this nomogram of the antral follicle count and then plan your dosage, then your stimulation protocol will follow. Most of the time, we read somebody saying 150 units is the optimal unit, somebody saying 225, somebody saying 250 units. But what we should do is, we should use these scientific data charts of antral follicle count and AMH and adjust our follicles, our starting dosage, based on either the AMH or the antral follicle. Then look at the follicle oocyte output index and see where we are finding our thing. Only then we can, in a very efficient way, give a good starting dosage. The other area of importance which I wanted to highlight is, sometimes we see an AMH value which is a couple of months back, and then the woman has an oral contraceptive pill, and then we start the dosage based on the AMH value, and then cut a sorry face that we did not get adequate number of oocytes. Similarly, a woman with type 1 diabetes has an AMH which is higher but may not get adequate number of follicles. Similarly, in rheumatoid arthritis and SLE, and in aggravated stage of Crohn's disease, and in situations where the C-reactive protein will alter your current AMH value, and your follicle sensitivity index decreases. That is where the word oocyte sensitivity index is coming in. Unless we validate this information in the current cycle by cross-checking our AMH value with AFC, and they are matching approximately, then we are not missing out a crucial point. We just look at the notes and think the AMH which was done a year ago is 504, and then in between the woman must have been in one of these situations, or in the recent 6 weeks to 8 weeks, she's in one of these situations, and then we end up land in a situation where the follicle sensitivity index or the oocyte sensitivity index is inappropriate, and then we get inappropriate number of follicles. This is one area seldom we speak about, and seldom it is mentioned in any of the articles except as one-liners in most of the top review articles. And when you go into the references, then you find the real information. But our community has failed in carry home in conveying the message that these are the factors which might alter our stimulation protocol. Then when we come to the possible situation of inadequate ovarian response, inadequate number of oocytes, the low follicle to oocyte index, which in a review article published by Carl Alweghi in the Frontiers of Endocrinology, this is an interesting article, Understanding Ovarian Hyporesponse to Exogenous Gonadotropins in Ovarian Stimulation and New Proposal Markers, where they enlisted five factors as the key factors of follicle inadequate number. One is the oocyte pickup. We seldom audit our oocyte pickup. Somebody does the pickup in a larger teams, and we do not know whether the pickup went smoothly and whether the pickup timing was right compared to the HCG. The second thing is the HCG dosing. Most of the time, we give the same amount of dosage based on, we never give the HCG based on the body mass index. We give HCG dosage, And sometimes what happens is you might be injecting the HCG dosage in an obese patient into the fat rather than into the subcutaneous tissue. So your LH search may not be proper, and inappropriate luteinization can be a cause. So the practice we follow based on an article about recombinant HCG was, if the BMI is more than 30, we make it a policy to give the HCG on the hand rather than the abdomen, because we might end up depositing the HCG into the fat tissue and the absorption profile is altered. The third is inappropriate dosage and inappropriate asynchronous adjusting the dosage will give you different cohorts of follicles, because now it is known that in a given menstrual cycle, there can be two or three cohorts of follicles developing. And if you adjust your dosage in an erratic fashion, like step-up protocol, then you're stimulating an asynchronous follicle development, and then you might have different sets of follicles, but not being dominant. The next most important is low starting dosage. And the last, but the main topic of this discussion will be the response due to gelatic polymorphism. In this next 20 minutes, I'll be basically dividing 10 minutes into low starting dosage. And we do not standardize the starting dosage. The starting dosage can vary depending on the body mass index, because obese women, the data shows they need large amount of gonadotropins. But how often are we standardizing what dose to be given to obese women? The second is a severe pelvic inflammatory disease or the frozen pelvis. The third is the endometrioma and the endometriotic surgery. The fourth is the collagen disorders. The fifth is recurrent ovarian surgery. The sixth is using one of the parameters called AFC or AMH, and then using the age as a starting dosage. So for our clinic, we devised a rough scale parameter called optimal dosage, which is a very crude thing, but this is what we follow. Here you have the age. So we have taken 30 years as a control. This starting dosage can be decided individually by clinic to clinic, and they based on the type of population you get it. So if the age of the woman is 30 years, this is the starting dosage. If the age of the woman I am going to start the stimulation is 25, then I minus 25 units. If it is 20, I minus another 25. My starting dose is 150. Then again, based on the BMI of 25, I might minus the dosage as the weight comes down, provided they're healthy, and increase the dosage as the weight increases. And I use only the AFC rather than the AMH because I'm giving it in that particular cycle. If I have an AMH between 8 to 16, then my starting dose is this. If it is less than 8, then I add another 25 units. If the AFC is more than 16, I minus 25. Then I also look at high levels of thyroid antibodies, especially the antimicrobial antibodies. And if they are very high in thousands, I add another 25 units. Then if the patient has significant psoriasis, not mild psoriasis, or long duration of collagen disorders with relapses and recurrences, and a recurrence of endometriosis, that's where I think, but I never cross 300 units. I might come as low as 75 units, but never cross 300 units. Using this scale, we find it in our day-to-day practice, our risk of hyperstimulation is very, very minimal. We never cross 300 units, even though this says this values cross 350 units or 400 units, we never cross 300 units. That's one of the things we do here. And we use only one single product, the recombinant FSH, and we don't change the product. The reason is each product has its strength and weaknesses. So in the process, when you're doing a stimulation, you have to control as many variables as possible. Then the next question is, in spite of giving adequate dose of FSH, the follicles are not growing, but you are seeing that is where the role of LH stimulation occurs. Without giving adequate dose of FSH dosage, you add LH, you're only wasting your time. So the key concept of a hyperresponder is you have given adequate dosage based on some of the criteria that are there in the literature. Then if the follicles are seen but they are not growing, that is when the key concept of LH comes in. So the role of LH in the last 20 years is changing. Initially, it was the empirical use of LH for all older women. Then in the years between 2000 to 2012, the ongoing hyperresponder. And in the year 2016, the Poseidon concept. And now I feel there are pharmacological to play. So the role of LH supplementation in an ovarian response is not for poor responder, but it's only for a hyper responder. And the concept is getting refined as follows. That is, earlier it was empirical, then they said ongoing poor responder. Then in 2016, the Poseidon group have come out with the Poseidon concept of 1-2, which are the hyper responders. 3 and 4 are the poor responders. And now our work is suggesting the role of pharmacogenomics. When we talk about ongoing hyperresponder, what does it mean? It says, after giving adequate amount of dosage based on your BMI, age, antral follicle count, or AMH, you're able to see good number of antral follicle count, but not many coming up, and your E2 levels are lower than the desired values on day 6 or day 8, that is when you're going to give LH supplementation. And this was beautifully summarized by PC Wong in an article that was published in 2011. And I was lucky to part of this group where this review article has been given. And I would be willing to share this article to the group because it makes interesting reading about the concept of hyperresponder in a much better way of all the articles I've read so far. Even though I'm the co-author here, the whole contribution was done by PC Wong and the Merck advisory group, who gave a lot of inputs when the writing was done. It's a very good article everybody should read to understand hyperresponder. So ongoing poor responder, addition of LH is with optimum dosage of FSH, lower rate of follicular growth, but you're able to count the follicles in your scan. And the E2 levels are disproportionately low to the value you're getting in. That is where the ongoing hyperresponder. Then came in 2016, the Poseidon concept, because in 2011, the Bologna criteria defined poor responder, but never defined the hyperresponder. And the Poseidon group felt that the initiative should be taken, which was led by Peter Humaiden, that a classification and a separation of the responders based on the age and the antral follicle count or AMH and the need for LH, that's how the Poseidon concept has come in. And I'll show you the concept in the next slide. So the Poseidon 1 and 2 are the upper two things, group 1 and group 2. And when you notice that group 1 and group 2 always have adequate AMH values. Whereas when it comes to group 3 and group 4, they are the poor responders. So the simulation protocols for group 1 and group 2 are different. Group 3 and group 4 are different. And what today we are speaking about is a group 1 patient or a group 2 patient, after we do a stimulation, we did not get adequate X. That is what we're addressing today. In a hyperresponder, with LH supplementation in the right patients in group 1 and group 2, you get what is there, you get what you get. That means when the number of eggs are more, you get adequate number of things, because the LH rescues the cycles. This is how that rescue happens. I'll be coming forward in the next slide. The role of pharmacogenomics next come in. In 2019, we have published the paper, The Role of LH Polymorphism and LH Supplementation in GnRH Agonistic Cycles, a cross-sectional study. This has helped us to understand. Till that time, we had, when we do a follicular stimulation, we had predictability issues. There are too many stimulation protocols, but what we believe is each clinic should select one or two protocols and use them judiciously, rather than 10 different protocols, so that you don't have a control. And the planning and quantification of your E2 levels and validating the thing. And based on that, this is the thing that is what happens till now. And using these parameters which I have discussed, which are predictors of ovarian response, which will help to do the stimulation. With the concept of the PC Wong from 2009 of hyperresponder, we started adding LH on the day 6 or day 8 when we found the follicles were not growing at the right speed. In that context, what we did was we felt that using LH supplementation made a difference. But subsequently, in 2012, we could acquire a gene sequencer and started doing the LH CGR, FSHR thing. At that time, we were ignorant the difference between an LH gene and an LH receptor gene. And similarly, we were ignorant about FSH gene and FSHR gene. But subsequently, we realized that LH gene abnormalities produce inactivating mutations, which sterility rather than infertility. Whereas when the receptor problem comes in, it's the response that makes a difference. And then we started understanding the relevance. And from 2014, we started doing it for every patient. And now we manage only by polymorphism. We have in-house sequencer. Then based on the lessons from the cross-sectional study and the subsequent longitudinal study, which we posted to all the SR members for sharing the knowledge, this is the study. And in this, what happened is the LH receptor gene has three major polymorphisms. Even though it has 500 polymorphisms, only three are important, of which two are significant. And we found in that two, only exon 10, 312 position change of amino at the base pairs makes a difference. That means in LHCGR, exon 10, position 312, if there's a change in the base pair of A by A, and the A by T replaced by T, then it makes a difference. So this is what the thing. So when we analyze the instance of this polymorphism in general population, in the infertile population, we found 19% of the patients with LHCGR gene polymorphism at position 312. They were homozygous or wild type in 19%, then heterozygous in 45%, and 34% are homozygous. These 34% patients might end up as hyperresponders, and that is where the role of Poseidon concept is coming in, the role of pharmacogenomics is coming in, the role of LH supplementation is coming in. So the key findings in the 2019 study was LH supplementation is needed in patients with this type of polymorphism. So the conclusions of the publication was heterozygous or homozygous for G allele are more likely to require recombinant LH supplementation. Heterozygous or homozygous for G alleles were 3.6 times and 5.81 times more likely to receive RH supplementation. This was a retrospective study. and these were the findings. We had another unique situation since we are doing polymorphism for everybody. Some of the patients whom we did LH supplementation based on hyperresponders came back 2 to 5 years later for the second cycle. And in the second cycle, we based the LH supplementation based on the genotype. And that is what the current study, which was published in May 15th, 2021, effect of LHCGR gene polymorphism. The RS is the new nomenclature that is coming in because it is producing a lot of confusion. So in future, most of the nomenclature will be based on RSW293275 on LH supplementation protocol retrospective study. Here, there were 193 couple with IVF cycle who had long GnRH with FSH LH supplementation. And after some years, which the gap was varying between 2 to 6 years, and in between couple of cycles outside, they came for a second cycle. And these people were categorized into one group. We had LH supplementation as per PC Wong criteria. That means LH supplementation being given from day 6. And the second group is based on the polymorphism, where there was a wild type A by A, no LH was given. If it is A by G, we gave half ampule of LH. And if we have given G by G, that is 1 ampule from day 1 supplementation, we found a huge difference. And the difference is seen as here. The light gray charts are the first cycles. The dark gray are the cycles which had LH supplementation from day 6. And the darker gray had LH supplementation from day 1 based on the pharmacogenomics. You see a difference in the biochemical pregnancy rate. And you also see a significant difference in the delivery rates. So in this group, we also studied the whole group up to the delivery. And the conclusions are the reasons for better pregnancy and delivery is optimization of LH dose and their role in pre-implantation diagnosis. What is the molecular basis for LH need in different genotypes? So in a 312 A by A, you have an amino acid called asparagine, which at the granular cumulus cell interface, it does not impact the signaling of cyclical AMP and does not tamper with the antigen. So in these patients, there is no need for LH supplementation. When it comes to 312 G by G, the amino acid is changed to serine. And in these patients, there's an impaired cellular signaling within the granular theca cells, and less cyclical AMP is produced, less antigen is produced. And here, there's a need for LH supplementation. So this is the transmembrane. This is cytoplasm, and this is where the cyclical AMP happens. So LH acts on the cyclical AMP pathway and increases and drives the growth of follicular fluid formation and the oocyte maturity. The concept is, if you have 312 A by A, that is the wild type, where the asparagine does not disturb the cyclical AMP and the antigens of the cell, there's no need for LH supplementation. If it is heterozygous, we give 37 units. And if it is 75 units, we give 1 ampule, but we never cross 75 units of LH. In the beginning years, we are given maybe for a year 150 units, but in the last 10 years, we never cross 75 units, that is 1 ampule of LH per day, with adequate amount of FSH. And this has helped us to improve our pregnancy. This study has provided a strong evidence in support of supplementation of LH to women undergoing IVF based on their SNP profile of LHCGR. This stimulation regimen provides optimal level of LH supplementation needed to improve the pregnancy and the live birth. So this is just the beginning of for the pharmacogenomics. And after this, we had an ad board, which is based on the Merck headquarters, where they're working on a Delphi consensus about the role of FSH and LH polymorphism in current practice. And in the next 5 years, we'll have plenty of articles in refining this thought process. So one might ask a question, if I don't have LH polymorphism, am I handicapped? The answer is no. If you are able to use good starting dosage and then carefully monitor the follicles and identify an ongoing hyperresponder, and if you give LH supplementation, most of the time it will help you. And the role of LH receptors is a scientific breakthrough, and with time, as the cost of those testings will come cheaper and more widely available, then I would advocate everybody to use it. Till then, my advocation is to use the concept of ongoing hyperresponder in as much situation as possible, and use genetic polymorphism in selected situations where you are in a dilemma. That is my key home message to the group. I thank you.
Thank you, sir. That was really an enlightening talk, especially the elaborate talk about receptor polymorphism and the dosage calculation part. I think we all would be very glad to hear that and would follow those charts. We expect a better response in our cycles now.
Thank you very much, sir. Sir, it's a great congratulations for your this paper presentation, and it's been accepted because I was there when you were doing this study of this LH concept, and I think now we'll invite our experts, Nika, one by one. But first of all, we'll welcome our Shada Jain ma'am, because she has joined late because of the there was a problem in the link. Dr. Shada Jain ma'am, are you hearing us?
Yes, I'm. Thank you very much. The concluding part I could hear. Sir, we definitely find we are at a handicap that we were not doing it, but your last words are definitely encouraging, and I would like to hear what Dr. Brigadier Sharma has to say about the whole thing. But you know what, we are definitely finding that the results which you used to get about 3-4 years back, we are not getting the same. There is something wrong, whether it's corona doing the problems or whether anything else is happening. We like to have an easy solutions. The problem is there are so many gurus around and we do not know whom to hear. Brigadier Sharma, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. In fact, both the lectures were academic feast today, and definitely they were above par our normal lectures what we hear. And I congratulate both the speakers. I think, firstly, regarding the Dr. Raju's lecture, you know, it was so scientifically explained and made so easy to understand, and I'm sure it is going to benefit all of us. And he brought out some very important points. You know, the most of the Indian women, they have a little more fat deposition over the abdomen. So in those cases, when you're giving HCG or even if you're giving agonist as a trigger, you find that in the response may not be as good. So under those circumstances, you know, choosing arm over the abdomen is a better choice. And that is a well brought out point by sir. And secondly, sir, what is your opinion? And you know, this unexpected poor responders, you know, you have added LH also. And since they don't, you know, respond, you know, the follicles are not growing at the same rate as you're expecting, and adding some steroids in those cases, like prednisolone and all. Do you have any word to say about that, sir?
I don't have adequate experience to comment on, but I've seen some other people adding steroids and getting a benefit. But there the caveat is, did you give adequate dose of FSH? Second thing is your FSH of good quality and there's no cold chain breakage? Because we have one policy which I advocate, whichever product you choose, stick to that product for at least a couple of years.
You have to have confidence in your products.
Yes. And second thing is, by changing the protocol, you will not get the grip of the product. The other thing is, see that there's a cold chain maintenance and verify that your cold chain in your own clinic is adequate.
Okay.
Because what happens is, the cold chain comes into our clinic, but there can be breakage in the clinic. Or the cold chain is broken by the time it comes to the clinic, and we are unaware of it. So sticking to one product, at least for a couple of years, makes us sure that the product we are using and the process we keep are good. And that makes a huge difference. How
would you manage? I agree with you, because the companies also would not like to lose you. So they will keep on giving you the best product. Otherwise, if you keep on changing the companies, they know that you're not their regular customer. So they may play with you and give you the products which are not maintained cold chain wise. What is your opinion about anti-ovary antibodies, anti-ovarian antibodies affecting the our response to the stimulation? Prednisolone concept was based on that only, actually.
Actually, many years back I used to check it, but I could not understand the concept properly, so I left it. So my knowledge is zero in that area.
Yeah, because though I have not tested anti-ovarian antibodies, but I do find that some patients, even after adding LH, they do not respond. But when I add steroids to them, they start responding better. The follicogenesis starts growing better. So this was my personal experience. I thought I'll share.
Basically what happens is, in India or anywhere, we keep on fiddling with the dose of stimulation.
Yeah, because the patients are also getting restless. They're watching how the ovaries are responding, and they will keep on thinking that, doctor, what are you doing? My response is not offering. Maybe adding on something which may or may not directly actually help. But in case the follicles are growing, then yes, E2 is increasing. So whatever you have done, it has possibly helped. It was time which helped, not the product.
The other thing which has helped us is, we store all the images of the stimulation protocol, and if something goes wrong, we go back and look at the ultrasound images, whether we assess them properly, that's the first question, whether we dose them properly. We also record every egg retrieval. We assess whether we did the egg retrieval at the right time, and did we take too long to do the egg retrieval, and what was the amount of follicular fluid we got compared to the usual. These are all the parameters we look at it. And there, if I'm having excess of follicular fluid, I don't expect good follicles or less number of follicles. And similarly, is my E2 levels correlating with my ultrasound image and the cervical secretions which I see on the day 4? Is the day 4 E2 levels coming too high quickly? These are some of the parameters I look into. We never assess cervix as part of stimulation protocol, but cervical assessment gives a beautiful information about the synchronicity of the ovary, the uterus, and the cervix, which is a valuable information, but we never document anywhere. And then we see the E2 levels, it's high or too low, but we never validate that information in relation to cervical secretions.
I agree with you. Actually, cervix, especially on transvaginal ultrasonography, if you look at the cervical canal, you get a lot of information about the estrogen levels, how the cervical mucus looks like on a ultrasound. But only thing, in case of chronic cervicitis, it may not match. That is the only little catch over there. Thank you very much, sir. Sushma Vaid madam also, you know, she brought the practical problems which we see day to day in cryo banking, and you know, she had a very bad experience, as she mentioned, you know, because you know, in especially in the corporate sector where 4 or 5 specialists are working, you know, somebody is doing better and somebody is not doing better, you know, they may play this type of games, which I you know, everybody is aware, you know, where the liquid nitrogen was removed from the tank and all the embryos, you know, though doctors should not fall to that level or embryologists should not fall to that level, but it does happen. So she rightly mentioned that, you know, we should have some cameras and all, so that, you know, the things are recorded in the laboratory and also in the cryo bank, so that we know, we can trace, you know, something goes wrong, you know, what has gone wrong and somebody has played mischief in that. Now, the another important point is that, you know, we have, say, embryologists who are going to many centers, that is one. And secondly, there are some teams who are going to the various centers, and or the teams which are working in the corporate sector. Now, whenever they leave that center, now the proper handing over of the embryos, you know, it should be mentioned in the MOU only in the beginning. This is just wanted to tell the new generation, whenever you sign an MOU with the corporate, you please mention what is going to be the disposal of embryos if you know, you leave that particular center. Because otherwise, you know, the patient have given the embryos to you, they have not given to the corporate hospital. So tomorrow they will take it to the court if you have not have a proper MOU with the corporate center, that what is going to happen with the embryos in your absence, or when they, you know, chuck you out, or if you leave that place. And secondly, the patient should also be told that, okay, we are freezing your embryos and I am responsible till such time I am here. After that, in case, you know, I have to move out for whatever reason, then the corporate hospital, because you are paying to the corporate hospital, they will be responsible. So they should not be troubling you after you have left the particular center. So this is a very important point, because in the times to come, this is going to happen, that the patients, you know, will sue you, the doctors or the embryologists, though the doctor has been removed by the corporate world, and the poor fellow will be, you know, unnecessarily be answering in the court, you know, what has happened to the embryos in his absence. So the proper, you know, the wording of the MOUs, and also to the patient awareness, the patient should be aware that if I leave, what is going to happen to their embryos. These are the few important points I thought I'll share.
You are absolutely correct, Dr. Karna Sharma. But what happens, the clinician, they will not inform the present working embryologist. They will just inform, they will just call the another embryologist. That is a very sad state of affairs. Although I have a very, I am very particular about the writing protocols and everything, nobody will have problem with that. But the unfortunate part is, the clinician, they all of a sudden decide and they call the other embryologist. And you are not aware of it. So, you know, everything has to be regularized.
Yeah, so it should be written the MOU in the beginning only. The embryologists, yeah, save their own skin, they should write down. And yeah, the team which is working, the clinician plus the embryologist team, they should also write down. And the patient should be made aware that what is, you know, the future of their embryos in case the embryologist or the team leaves that particular place.
One good thing is, I think our finally our fertility bill is being listed in the parliament.
Yeah, I don't know, you know, the Indians, you know, really know how to find the ways out, and the doctors are always the scapegoat. You know, they will tell you, do this thing for me, and, you know, finally the doctors will be bearing the brunt of whatever is happening in this society.
Actually, what happens is, what I feel is, once the law comes in, our society should have regulatory outside bodies and suggest modifications to the law, and develop relations with the standing committee, so that what happens is, in future the law will become better, but it will not happen overnight, but it will take a decade's time.
The thing is, the way the AIT centers are mushroomed throughout the country, you know, the bill which is going to be there, this is going to affect mainly the cosmopolitan cities. You know, like the people are doing the sex selection in the smaller cities and all. So similarly, this people will find loopholes in this also and go to the smaller cities and do all mischief there. And we all get the bad name in return.
True, sir. What you say is partly true, sir.
Dr. Sunita and Dr. Shivani want to make a comment. Please do it.
Thank you for having me, Dr. Seema, Dr. Sharda, ma'am. Thanks. And both the talks were wonderful. I heard a lot about Dr. Ramaraju, but I heard him for the first time. It was a fantastic talk, sir. All practical points you have enumerated so well, and that particular picture of, you know, depending upon BMI and your baseline and how you subtract and increase the doses, it is explained so well. Sir, I just have one question that for morbidly obese patients, do you ever increase the dose of trigger from what you actually give?
The answer is yes.
Okay, and suppose you decide for an agonist trigger in that case, so do you give, like I give 0.2, so do you ever say 0.3, move on to 0.2?
Earlier we were only doing agonist, but of late in a year we have moved to antagonistic protocol. And giving HCG, because what happens is risk of hyperstimulation is less in obese women because the number of follicles will be less. The risk will be more from a thromboembolic mechanism. So, and there I would refer to samples of recombinant HCG. And
from 2 amperes, sir, you are using.
So normally we use 6,500 units.
Right.
BMI crosses 30, we routinely give 2 amperes, and if it is 35, again 2 amperes. But we discourage anybody who's closer to 38 and 40, as much as possible, not to start a cycle. But a few times in a year, we are given to that pressure. But there, I do it very unhappily.
I know. Yeah, thank you, sir. And Dr. Sushma's talk was also wonderful. And, you know, we are clinicians, so it was so good to hear an embryologist speaking on vitrification. And vitrification, as all of us know, has really been a boon to IVF world. And since this is in, you know, existence, so many cases of oocyte freezing and, you know, embryo pooling and even segmental IVF, surplus embryos, it's really been so good. Dr. Sushma, can you just tell me one thing? Like, you know, I also presented something on vitrification, and I read about spindle view, which they say that its recovery is faster if you compare slow freezing with vitrification. But are embryologists really practicing it, that viewing at the, you know, spindle recovery before the oocyte is used for ICSI, or it is only theoretical thing?
I don't have much experience about the oocyte freezing.
I would like to add a few things. We used Poloscope in the earlier years, and we had a publication, but it's time consuming to do a spindle view of each of the oocyte and then select those oocytes for vitrification. Because what happens is, ultimately, you should have adequate amount of survival rate and adequate fertilization. That's the bottom line we are looking at. In the beginning, maybe for 10 cases to 15 cases, we did the spindle view because we had the Poloscope, but we didn't really found it practical, because we find any tool should be seamlessly integrated, simple to use, and repeatable on a long-term basis.
Right, sir.
Yes, ma'am, thank you so much for your talk. In fact, I had a patient waiting who was in doubt about vitrification and freezing, so I took my phone out and I showed her part of your presentation that, see, this is cryopreservation and you should not worry about it. It has really good outcome. So thank you so much. I really enjoyed your presentation. And sir, I wanted to ask you, Dr. Ramaraju, sir, you are doing FSH receptor polymorphism tests for patients as well?
Yes, ma'am. We are doing it since 2011 for every patient. And only from 2019, after the publication of the paper, we started charging the patient.
Right. So, sir, how much does it cost like this for our sake? Because we are not doing it. So,
we charge around 10,000 rupees for FSHR polymorphism and LH polymorphism. And in the FSHR, we look at 29. 680 and 307, and in LH we look at 6 base pair insertion at exon 1 and 312 position at the exon 10 position.
Okay, thank you, I just wanted to know about that. Thank you, thank you, it's such an honor. Thank you, Meenakshi, thank you very much.
I saw Dr. Malik also here. Dr. Malik wishes to make any comment.
Dr. Jyoti Malik.
Any last minute comments by anybody? Dr. Seema Sehgal?
Dr. Jyoti Bali is also here.
Jyoti Bali is also there, ma'am. Dr. Jyoti Bali, please. Your comments, please.
Dr. Jyoti Bali.
I think she's left. Ma'am, your experience about poor responders. Dada, ma'am, practical tips.
See, I was asking Dr. Shivani the other day, Dr. Saab, that Raju sir is doing all these tests. Are you doing it or not? She said, I'm not doing it, Dr. Jain. For a theory sake, I definitely teach people. So I think Dr. Raju should suggest some good lab here. So we all should, under your guidance, start doing it. Because I think it is a collective effort which will do good for the society. If you think, you know, you have got something trump card, or I call it a Ramban, that you should share it with everybody. If not so many people, at least 50 people you should be able to influence, and they should start doing the similar kind of work. People like me, I always hear what Dr. R.K. Sharma says, but we are ready to listen to you and want to make you as a part of the group. So what will be your suggestion as far as the Delhi IVF experts are concerned?
I can be part of that group for 6 months where I can answer everything, and at the end of the 6 months, I can exit the group.
So nice of you, sir.
So how frequently you will like to come and address us? So at least we like Seema Sehgal, we have not been lucky to work with you, but I'm sure through this talk we should be able to hear more about it and what is in your mind.
I mean, as and when you plan it, I'm ready, madam.
Perfect. Right. Perfect.
So we'll trouble you once a month, sir.
There's no problem, ma'am.
Every 20th we have decided this day as an infertility update. So we'll be disturbing you, and we'll be like with that.
And, we can create a group temporarily for 6 months where whatever doubts that are there, I can support.
Today is a group, sir. All experts are there. I'll add you also. That.
And at the end of 6 months, then I'll exit so that what happens is it's a good way of doing things.
So 6 months is a lot of time.
Sir, in this particular group, we find very senior. Brigadier Sharma is, I call him guru of gurus as far as IVF is concerned, and so is Dr. Sushma Vaid. She has got such a large experience as an embryologist, and I have been working with her for a very long time. I have a pleasure of working. And I find, you know, the story she must have shared today is the sad part of the clinical practice which is going on in the city like Delhi. And I feel, you know, it will be a pleasure having you here. And I'm sure Dr. Seema Sehgal will see to it that, you know, your presentation is there for all of us to hear, because many people like me could not join today.
We have recorded this session, and we are sharing that.
I would admire one thing, Dr. Sushma's saying the truth, but telling the truth in a way.
That's what
she did.
6 months, we would all be benefited. Thank you so much, Dr. Raju sir, for agreeing to do that. And Dr. Sadhana, you have created such a group. Hum sab ka bhala ho jayega is tarike se. Thank you so much.
I joined IVF very late in comparison to the other people, but I, as a good clinician, I definitely get worried, you know, why I'm not having results so good as other people are having. Are they telling truth or are they not telling the truth? So that's what I am always in a dilemma. So I will definitely like to hear from the honest, henceforth, outright people who are ready to teach.
I want to share something. For my vitrification, that credit goes to Dr. Ramaraju. There was a book on IVF by Dr. Mangala Telang. I think it was 2007 or 2008. And Dr. Karnitra Sharma at a conference, he told me that you have to speak on vitrification, which I had never done it. So I go on with the last chapter. That is the last chapter of vitrification by Dr. Ramaraju. I read it. I told Dr. Sonia Malik, you order the vitrification media unless until I do, I work on it, I want to speak. So she ordered the vitrification media. I did freezing and I thawed it. I did a vitrification, I thawed it, and they reached to blastocyst. Then I was assured, and I am so thankful for that small chapter by Dr. Ramaraju. And thanks to Dr. Karnitra Sharma also.
In fact, Dr. Ramaraju joining us would raise the academic level of this forum.
Very nice. Surely, sir. Thank you so much, sir, for joining us. And thank you, Sushma ma'am, too, for your lecture. And I would like to thank all our speakers and our panelists. It was a wonderful discussion. I think we discussed all the practical points, and we would continue this every month with the same enthusiasm and zeal. Thank you so much for joining.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Shah.